Okay, so last time we looked at the pseudorandom generator realistically, and then we already know that one-time path can be secure, right? Perfectly secure, but stream cipher case, it cannot be because the key size is shorter than the message size, right? So which means that we need another definition for the stream cipher or pseudorandom generator. So let's look at the definition of security for pseudorandom generator. Okay, so pseudorandom generator is like this. Key is given. So G is a pseudorandom generator. Key is given. Then this function G is generating n-bit binary, right? That is pseudorandom generator. So then our goal is that the pseudorandom generator output should be very similar to the random stream, right? So output is very similar to the random, then we can say that, okay, so this pseudorandom generator is really secure, right? So our goal is we are taking the key value from key space, so randomly, and then we are outputting the bit string using pseudorandom generator G, so that string, and then we are trying to distinguish whether that string is different from really random. So really random means it is randomly chosen from n bit. So we are just choosing the n bit and then outputting the random. So if there is someone who is trying to distinguish whether given bit string is from the random or is from the pseudorandom output, if it is not gonna be distinguishable, then we can say that it is secure things. So what does it mean is, n bit string is very large. This is n bit string, n bit string, n bit binary. So how many cases we can find? How many cases from 0000000000000001001011111, right? So how many cases we can find if this is n bit? Yeah. Two to the n cases, right? So there are two to the n cases. What about that output of GK? How many cases? Is it depending on the K, right? If K is given, then GK is a fixed bit string. So how many GK cases? Is it depending on the K size, right? So if K is only S bit, then how many cases? To the S, right? So random case, there are two to the N cases. Among them, small cases actually can be two to the K value. So maybe.
She's like I guess actually the smallest person in my family.
So for instance, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0. So some of them among the two to the N, only some of them can be belonging to the GK output value. Okay, it's much smaller. So this is given. So this is given in the case if like a 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1. So this is given to the some algorithm. So in this case, the algorithm can distinguish whether this is belonging to the G to the K or not. Okay, so that's the question. If this is easily testable, then it is distinguishable. If it's not going to be distinguished, then it is indistinguishable. So for a given bitstream, we have to decide whether this is belonging to the GK. So should randoms output or not, right? So that will be the distinguishable meaning or indistinguishable meaning. Actually, we didn't define it yet, right? It's just a textual representation. So we are looking at this terminology a little bit more mathematically. So first, let's think about statistical test. For given n bit stream, so like this, this is n bit stream. We can think about some statistical test. So statistical test means that by looking at this binary bit stream, it is trying to do something. So this algorithm A is trying to do generate output 0 or 1. Okay. So this algorithm is actually trying to distinguish whether this has some property or not. So for instance, we can think about some statistical test like A, X is 1, X is stream, if and only if. This test is looking at the how many 0 and how many 1 is there. So number of 0 in X minus number of 1 in X is less than something, like less than 100. Then is it saying that this is 1? So the number of 0 and number 1 is not going to be so many different, or it will be 2. 1 or 2. So we can think about any kind of statistical test. Second, AX will be 1 if and only if number of 0, 0. X is comparing the N of 4, that it will be less than something. Then AX is returning 1. So we can think about many kind of statistical test, right? Any kind of test, which is just looking at the bit stream. It's just testing things. So what does it mean is that this test is just looking at the, if it's really random, X is really random, then number 0 and number 1 will be very similar, right? If really random. Where number of 0, 0, if for the random stream, number of 0, 0 is n of 4, right? With high probability. So this statistical test is just testing about the given bit stream. Okay. So we will define the advantage. So G is a pseudorandom generator that is given. So random generator is given. A is the statistical test. Actually, A is just algorithm, any algorithm. We don't know what this algorithm is. We have no idea, but just think about there is an algorithm. This algorithm, for this algorithm, we are giving some NB string. Okay, so we are providing NB string to the A. Then we are defining advantage. Advantage for this PLG, pseudorandom generator. So here we are providing the algorithm A and pseudorandom generator G. Okay, so pseudorandom generator on algorithm A. We are defining that. So we don't know what algorithm is actually used, but anyway, first case, we are choosing some key value from the key space, and then to algorithm A, we are providing the output of pseudorandom generation output value. So we are providing the pseudorandom generated output value to algorithm A. So algorithm A is receiving the pseudorandom generation bit. Then algorithm A is trying to distinguish whether the input is random or pseudorandom, right? So if algorithm A is thinking that the input stream is pseudorandom, then it's returning one. Okay, we can just think about that. So input is random, it is returning zero, and input is pseudorandom, then it's returning one. So what we are assuming is that A is trying to distinguish whether this is from the random or is from the pseudorandom. Okay, so that's the algorithm. So to A, we are giving some pseudorandom input, then A is returning one. So then it's correctly guessing that probability. And then we are just comparing that R is really randomly chosen. NB string. And then to this random, we are providing R to A. Then A is just thinking that still this is from the pseudorandom. Okay. That difference is defining the advantage. So what does it mean is that if this advantage is close to one, what does it mean? A can distinguish pseudorandom bit and random bit, or it cannot distinguish. If advantage is one, that means algorithm A can distinguish, right? For given bit stream, if it's random, it's returning zero. If it's pseudorandom, then it's returning one. Right? So it's guessing probability. So this case, A can distinguish G, K from random. If advantage is close to zero, what does it mean? For given input, A is returning the same probability, right? So guessing is the same. So that means A cannot distinguish. So for instance, we are giving GK to the A, and then A is returning one, so correctly guessing. That probability is, let's assume that this is 0.9. So correctly guessing is 0.9. But even we are giving the random value to the A, then A is returning one. It's incorrect, right? It's incorrect. That is also 0.9. So in that case, advantage is zero. That means algorithm A cannot distinguish whether the input is pseudorandom or real random. Okay. Let's look at a very silly example. Algorithm A, if we are giving some bit stream, algorithm A is not looking at the bit stream. Just algorithm A is returning zero. That means any definition, okay. Algorithm A is thinking that, okay, X is really random. Okay, so algorithm is just returning zero. So in this case, what's the advantage of A for G? Yeah. So in this case, probability A GK case is one that is zero, right? Because A is always returning zero. So that probability is zero. Really random is given, then it's one, that probability is also zero because A is always returning zero. So the difference is also zero. What about this case? AX is always returning one. In that case, what's the advantage? What's the advantage? Yeah, it is also zero because AGK is one. In this case, A is always returning one. So this is always true. It's one. Random is given at one. That probability is also one. So anyway, one minus one is zero. So any case, A cannot distinguish whether this is random or from the pseudorandom. Okay, so we will define these advantage things. So this advantage will be used a lot. So you have to remember this advantage. Okay, so then let's look at some example about this advantage computation. So suppose there is a pseudorandom generator G for given K and MB string is output. And for this G, this G output is satisfying that this relation. So that means the most significant, the first bit is always one. Okay. Not every case, two-third of key case, the first bit is one, one-third case, first bit will be zero. So for example, key is 00 01 10. There are three keys, okay? And G00 case is starting from one. G101 case is also starting from one. G10 case is from zero, okay? So this is given, okay? This kind of thing is given. Then, we are thinking about the statistical test A, algorithm A, defined like this. If X, first bit is looking, if the first bit is one, then A is returning one. Otherwise, it's turning zero. Okay, so A algorithm is setting like this. So let's say this is anything, okay. This is random or not, we don't care about that. Anyway, algorithm A is designed like this. So given the bit stream, the first bit is one, then is returning one. So algorithm A is thinking that this is from the pseudorandom. Otherwise, it's from the random, okay? So then let's compute advantage. A on G, okay? So algorithm A for this G. So what about the probability of A for given pseudorandom bit case? What's the probability of that? Yeah. Two-third case. So pseudorandom case is depending on the key, right? Okay. Which key is chosen, the probability will be changing. Two-third case, the first will be one, right? So two-third case, the first one, the second one is chosen, then the guessing is true. If the 10 is chosen, then guessing will be incorrect. So it will be two-third, right? It's depending on which key is chosen. So two-third case, that will be true. What about the really random is given to A? In the case, what's the first bit? What's the probability of first bit is one? Yeah, it is half. Right? Random case, half of bit is starting zero, half of bit is starting one. So if random bit is given, then half case only the first bit is one. Right? So then what's the difference? 1 over 6. So 1 over 6 is small or it's large? It's negligible or is non-negligible? It's non-negligible. Right? It's non-negligible. So this G is insecure. Because there is some algorithm which can distinguish whether it's from the pseudorandom or really random. So the algorithm is existing, then we can say that this is insecure. So we are defining G, pseudorandom G is secure pseudorandom generator if for all efficient algorithm, efficient means that it should be fast. It takes only polynomial time. Efficient algorithm. Okay. Advantage. AG is negligible. So any algorithm cannot distinguish whether the given bitstream is from the pseudorandom or really random. Then we can say that this is a secure. Okay? So if there is a single algorithm we can distinguish, then this is insecure. But any algorithm cannot distinguish, then we can say that this is secure. Any fast algorithm. Okay? So then maybe you can ask, are there provable secure PLG? Is there any provable secure PLG? Actually, as I mentioned, there is no. So theoretically, we can assume that, okay, this is a secure PLG, then we can construct some crypto algorithm. But we cannot make a secure PLG currently. So instead of that, we are just using heuristic. Like what algorithm last time we learned? Salsa 20, that is currently used, heuristics. So it was used like RC4, CSS, right? So these are broken. So it cannot be used as a heuristic candidate. We have to use Salsa 20 currently. Maybe in the future, Salsa 20 can be broken. In that case, we have to invent new heuristic for this secure PLG. Okay. So anyway, the reason why we have defined the secure PLG is that if there is a secure PLG, then based on that, we can make some secure crypto system, theoretically. That's the reason. So for the PLG, we learn about the predictable and unpredictable. Right? Predictable and unpredictable. So let's think about the relationship between predictable and secure PLG. So the first one is secure PLG is unpredictable. So we can prove. So secure PLG means advantage is negligible. In that case, we cannot predict the bit. So what is counter-positive of this predicate? Counter-positive is P, if P is true, then Q. What's the counter-positive? Not Q, if not Q, then not P. So we'll prove not Q, then is inducing the not P. So we will show that PLG is predictable, then PLG is insecure. Okay, so we'll look at this one. So PLG is predictable. What does it mean? Predictable means that there is a predictor, right? Predictor. Predictor is receiving the from the one to the i's bit stream, and then is predicting the next bit, right? So there is an efficient algorithm such that probability of A, we are providing some bit stream from G to the from I to the one to the I speed. Then using the bit stream, A is guessing the following bit. So guessing the following bit, next bit. I plus one speed. That guessing is correct. The probability is non-negligible. So if this is really random, then what's the probability of that? If it is random, so A cannot distinguish, then it just half. But it's not random. That means there is epsilon, right? So this is non-negligible. Okay, non-negligible, epsilon is existing. Okay, so A is existing, right? Using this A, what you can do is we can make another algorithm B, which is breaking PRG. So what does it mean is using this A, we are making algorithm efficient algorithm B such that advantage B over G is more than non-negligible. So if we can construct this B, then G is insecure. Okay, so we have to make this algorithm B, which is breaking the pseudorandom generator using algorithm A. So that means, anyway, we have to make some algorithm B, right? So how we can make up algorithm B? So for given input string, we will do like this. B, algorithm B is learning algorithm A. So A, for given X, we are just providing the I bit to A, then A is guessing the next bit, right? So next bit, I plus one speed, if it's equal, if it's equal, then we can say that algorithm B is thinking that output one. That means it's a pseudo-random generation bit. So some bit is given, then from one to I speed is given to the algorithm A. And then using algorithm A, we are comparing that output is same to the X I plus one speed. If it's equal, then we are saying that it's from the pseudorandom generated bit. Otherwise, you can say that it's from the really random. Okay? So we are making this test, this algorithm. So this algorithm is efficient because it's only learning the algorithm A, right? And just if statement. Algorithm A is assumed efficient algorithm. So it's a very efficient algorithm. Then let's compute advantage. P over G, which is probability. We are providing the pseudorandom bit, and then is saying the one minus really random is provided to the B, and then is saying one. Okay, so that's the definition of advantage. What is the first value? Pseudorandom bit is given to the algorithm B. Then what is the probability of B is up one? So algorithm A is totally depending on the algorithm A, right? Algorithm A case, algorithm A, if the pseudorandom bit is given, then algorithm A is correctly guessing with half plus epsilon probability, And what about the second one? Really random is given then. You just have. There was a difference. Yeah, difference is epsilon. Right. So epsilon is negligible and non-negligible? Non-negligible. So that advantage is non-negligible. Advantage is non-negligible. Okay, so advantage non-negligible means is insecure because there is some statistical test which can distinguish whether the input is pseudo-random or is coming from the really random with non-negligible probability. So it's insecure, right? We can construct this algorithm. So we can break it using algorithm A, okay? So we know that secure pairs is unpredictable, right? So, or predictable is insecure. So predictable then is insecure. What of the opposite case, reverse? If unpredictable PRG, then is secure. So it's also proven. So we will not introduce the proof of this one, but anyway, this is also true. So PRG is unpredictable, then it's also secure. And is it secure, then it's unpredictable. So PRG is unpredictable. Then PRG is secure. And reverse is also possible, so that is equivalent. So PRG is unpredictable, then PRG is secure, PRG is secure, and PRG is unpredictable. It's the same thing. So that means, so the final sentence, if next bit predictor cannot distinguish from G from random, so there is no predictor, then there is no statistical test for given string, whether that is random or is random, because predictable and secure is equivalent things. Okay, so then let's look at this example. There is a pseudorandom generator. And what this pseudorandom generator is doing is, there is some property. For this GK, from the last half bit, we can compute the first half bit. Okay, so there are bit stream. Using the last half bit, we can compute the first half bit. Is it predictable or is it unpredictable? We don't know that, right? Predictable case, some bits are given, then we can predict next bit, right? So we don't know is it predictable or unpredictable, but anyway, is it secure or not? Secure? Secure means bits are given. There is no algorithm which is distinguish whether this is this is from the random or this is from the pseudo-random. It's insecure, right? Because if X is given, then usually we can do that by looking at the half bit and then generating the first half bit. If it's the same, then is it from the pseudorandom. Really random case, using the last half bit, generating first half bit will not be different. Right? So this is insecure. Then it is predictable or it's unpredictable. Yeah, predictable, because we already mentioned that predictable is equivalent to insecurity, insecure. Secure, then unpredictable. Same thing, right? So if we can find insecure, then it is also predictable. Okay. Okay, so more generally, we are talking about some distribution, P1 distribution, P2 distribution over M bit. We are saying that P1 distribution and P2 distributions are computationally indistinguishable, denoted as P1, P2 are similar or indistinguishable. Computational means very with an efficient algorithm. With efficient means polynomial time algorithm. So we are saying that P. So P means it is using polynomial. Time algorithm case, we cannot distinguish whether the given bit stream is from the P1 or is from the P2. We cannot distinguish. In the case, we are saying that computationally indistinguishable. Okay? Computational means there is no efficient algorithm. If computational is not there, then that means it's totally, perfectly indistinguishable. So the definition of this one is, if for all efficient algorithm A, probability, so we are choosing some bit stream from P1, like a pseudorandom generation output, and then we are providing that X to algorithm A, and then algorithm A is saying that it's from the P1. Then X is from the P2, and we are providing X to A, and still is saying that it's from the 1. That difference. So that is actually advantage, right? That's advantage. That is negligible. It's almost zero. So that means there is no algorithm A which is distinguished whether given bit stream is from the P1's output or P2's output. Then we are saying that this is computationally indistinguishable. So using this notation, we can say that like this, PLG is secure. There are two distributions. One is GK distribution, pseudorandom generation, right? Pseudorandom generation distribution and uniform random. This is really random. So uniform random and pseudorandom, that distribution is very similar for every efficient algorithm. Then it's a secure. So same definition to the last one. Okay, so we are defining the secure PLG, right? Secure PLG. So you can understand what is secure PLG, right? Advantage is negligible. which means that there is no efficient algorithm that distinguish whether the given bit stream is from the pseudo-random output or really random output. So we cannot distinguish, and it is secure purity. So then what we are doing is we will define the security of stream cipher. So that's the goal of the reason why we are defining the advantage and some distinguishability, indistinguishable computation. Okay, so we will defining semantic security. Semantic. So when we are learning about the one-time path, what security is defined? At the time, we learn about some security, right? What security is called? Do you remember? Yeah, perfect. Perfect security. Perfect security is the best. Perfect security case for given ciphertext, there is no way whether this ciphertext is from the M0 sub encryption output or M1 sub output. Okay, so that's perfect. Semantic security is a little bit different. So we cannot achieve the perfect security. Semantic security case, we cannot distinguish from the given ciphertext is from the M0, M1 using the efficient algorithm. So that will be different. So perfect security case, any algorithm cannot distinguish from M0 or M1. Semantic security case, any efficient algorithm. That's the difference. So perfect security case, any inefficient algorithm cannot distinguish. Efficient or inefficient, any algorithm cannot. Semantic security case, only efficient algorithm cannot distinguish. That means maybe inefficient algorithm can distinguish, but we don't care about that. Inefficient algorithm means that maybe it takes like more than 100,000 years, so then it's okay, right? So that's reasonable. So our goal is, if there is a secure PRG, so PRG is secure, then stream cipher is also secure. Okay. So we are already defining what is a secure PRG, right? So now we will define what is secure stream cipher. So we will define security of the stream cipher first. So we are defining semantic security. Okay. So actually last time we already looked at it. So what is a secure cipher? First, we have to assume that what is attacker's ability, right? What ability attacker has. So we're just assuming that attacker can look at the ciphertext, only one ciphertext. Attacker just looking at the single ciphertext only. Then we have to define some secure security, right? The first attempt was attacker cannot recover secret key, but we already mentioned that this is not going to be good definition, right? Because if this is a secure definition, then maybe this is also secure encryption, but this is not going to be secure. Second attempt is that attacker cannot recover all of plain text, but this is also insecure, not good definition because if like M0 is just revealed, but still attempt two is satisfied, but we don't think that this is secure, right? So that we think about that, Shannon's idea, which is ciphertext reveals no information. Any information is leaked. Then we are saying that this is secure. So that is called perfect secrecy. So perfect security is best, right? So perfect security is like this. There are two algorithms, encryption algorithm and decryption algorithm. So it's a cipher. Key, message, plain text, and ciphertext. Space. Okay. So perfect secure SIM means any M0, M1. We are giving the constraint M0's length and M1's length are equal. So lengths are equal. So two messages are given. Then the encryption of this M0 and encryption of M1. That distribution is equivalent. That means if the ciphertext is given, then we don't know this is from the encryption of M0 or from the M1. We don't know that. Okay, so it's just equal. Then we are saying that this is perfect secrecy. Now we are defining, this is incorrect. It should be semantic security. Okay, we are defining semantic secrecy. Semantic secrecy case for all M0, M1, for any message, the encryption. So encryption means a ciphertext, then another encryption, M1, ciphertext. Then the distribution is very similar. So which means that we cannot distinguish in a polynomial time. So ciphertext is given, then it is from the M0's encryption or M1's encryption. We don't know that within a short time. Maybe like 100,000 years later, we can distinguish whether this ciphertext from the M0 or M1. But it's okay because it takes more than this time, then we can say that this is secure, right? So that's the semantic security. So semantic security case, maybe it can be broken or it can be decrypted if we are paying a lot of time, but long time, but it's okay, practically it's okay. So that's the reason why we are defining the semantic security. Perfect security case, even we are infinite time spending, we cannot break. So that is perfect security. Okay. So here, for all message, okay? For all message. So attacker can distinguish like just single two message, then we are saying that this is insecure. For any message case, attacker cannot distinguish, okay? So if two message can be after encryption, we can distinguish it, then we are saying that this is insecure cipher. For any message, we can't. So for all messages, it's very difficult to represent, right? So we cannot, it's not easy to consider every case. So instead of considering every case, what we are doing is we are allowing that adversary can M0, M1 at wish. So adversary is choosing M0, M1 arbitrarily. For that M0, M1, adversary cannot distinguish, then we are saying that this is secure. Even adversary is choosing. So adversary is trying to best M0, M1, right? But adversary cannot succeed, then we can say that it's secure. So to defining this semantic security, we will generally using the game, okay? So we are using the game-based definition. Game-based semantic security. definition. So in the semantics, game-based semantics Qt, we have two entity. One is attacker. So here there is attacker. So attacker, we are saying that adversary. Adversary. So adversary means it's attacker. And then is this part is algorithm. This algorithm is called challenger. Okay, so game-based means that there is a game between challenger and adversary. So first, what adversary is doing is, adversary is choosing two messages, M0, M1 from the message space. And there is a constraint, M0 size is equal to the M1 size. Then adversary is giving this M0, M1 to the challenger. Then challenger is choosing random bit, one bit. And also challenger is choosing the key space, and then encrypting using K for this MB. So B is zero, then N0 is encrypted. B is one, then M1 is encrypted. Okay. And then challenger is keeping the ciphertext only. Then adversary is trying to guess C is from M0 or M1, okay? So that means A is guessing what is B, okay? So that is B, what is B? So B prime is opting. So B prime is 0 or 1, okay? So from the given ciphertext, adversary is trying to distinguish whether the ciphertext is encryption of M0 or M1 without knowing the key value. Okay. So this adversary is should be efficient, okay? So actually this is attacker or adversary, but actually A is algorithm to break the system, okay? So for all efficient A, so algorithm A, algorithm adversary A, advantage A over this cipher E encryption is, so advantage is defining, it's like this, probability, there are two cases. Challenger is choosing the one. B is choosing one. In that case, adversary is returning one, right? This case is there. And then different case is, challenger is choosing the zero. Then B prime is one. So, input is from the M0's encryption. Then A is saying that, okay, it's from the M1's encryption. And M1 is encrypted for that given message. A is saying that, okay, it's from the M1's encryption. So there's two cases. So B1, that's the M1 is encrypted. B0, that means M0 is encrypted. Two different strings, right? This is encryption of M1. This is encryption of M0. So two different bit stream is given to the A. But A is saying that this case, okay, it's from the M1. And still this case also, From the M1. M1. Okay. So that difference is defined as advantage, as we already look at it. So here, what is that? So it is M to the power T. Ciphertext. So we are providing the ciphertext. One is given and is saying the one. The property. Then we are providing the ciphertext zero, which is encryption of M0. Then it's still one. That difference is negligible. Then we are saying that E is semantically secure. Okay, that's the definition. So M0, M1 is chosen by adversary, which means that this meaning is for all message M1, M0, M1, right? Because adversary is choosing the message. Okay. So that's the game based semantic security. So which is also appeared in this slide, but this slide is actually same to the previous things, okay? So this is the same thing. Okay, so then let's try to define the, what a semantic security for the stream cipher. So here I already mentioned semantic security advantage is negligible, then we are saying that this is semantically secure for all M0, M1. Encryption, M0's encryption, M1's encryption distributions are computationally indistinguishable. Okay, then we are saying that's semantically secure. Okay, so let's look at the example. So one example. Suppose efficient algorithm A can deduce least significant bit of the plain text from the ciphertext. So from the ciphertext, we can extract the last bit. Okay, last bit of plain text. So in this case, let's look at this is a secure or is insecure. Okay, so let's look at it. So what we are doing is we are making the algorithm adversary B, which is breaking the encryption algorithm using algorithm A. Okay. So algorithm B is trying to break the cipher system using algorithm A. Okay. So algorithm B is choosing M0 M1, right? In the semantic security definition, first adversary is choosing the message. So what message is chosen is that adversary B is choosing two messages, M0, M1, such that last bit, M0 is zero. Last bit, M1 is one, okay? So any message is okay. So adversary B can choose these two messages. And then these two M0, M1 is given to the challenger. Okay. Then challenger is choosing one bit and key, and then compute encryption and given the ciphertext. Ciphertext is given to B. algorithm B. Then algorithm B is receiving this CIPA test, and then algorithm B is learning algorithm A. Algorithm A is that if the C is given, then last bit is coming out, right? Plain text, last bit of the plain text. So C is given, then some bits are given. Okay, maybe 0 or 1. Then algorithm B is just returning the last bit, the output as a result. Okay, so in that case, let's look at what's the advantage. So what is the advantage? So let me draw. So there is two things, challenger and adversary. Adversary B. M0, M1 is chosen. Something 0, something 1. And this is given, then B is chosen, and then key is also chosen randomly, and then C is inclusion of key and B is given, then this is provided to the algorithm A. Algorithm is generating the LSB of MB. So this will be 0 or 1, right? So if it's 0, then it's M0, 1 is M1. Okay. So this is returning. Anything is okay. Maybe it's returning just that output as a result, B prime. Where you can say that the other case also. So here in this case, let's compute advantage. Advantage B. The CIPER is probability. Okay, so challenger is choosing the 0. In that case, is it saying the 1? And then difference, B prime is 1 when B equal 1. Okay, let's look at it. What's the first case? M0 is chosen, right? The CIPA test is given to the A. Then what's the result of A in the case? So this case, CT0 is given. Then what will be the output of A? If we are providing A to the inclusion of M0, then what is output? Yeah, 0, right? A is returning 0. So that means what's the probability of B prime is 1 in the case? It is always B prime is 0, right? Not 1. So it is 0. So first one is 0. Okay. So probability of the first one is 0. Okay. What about the next one? To A, we are providing the M1. then there will be a return of 1. Then B prime or is 1. So it is 1. So advantage is 1. Okay. Even any case is same thing. B prime is 0, B equal 0, PR B prime is 0, B equal 1. It is also same. So in this case, first one is 1, second one is 0. So any combination is. So here, one you have to be remember is that last part is every case, every distribution. So distribution. In the case, this is answer. B is answer, right? Answer should be same. So then we can distinguish it. Okay. So here, this case, it is insecure cipher. Because there is efficient algorithm which can distinguish whether the ciphertext is from the M0 or M1. Okay. Any question? So you have to remember about this. Semantic security. We will look at the semantic security a lot. Okay. So advantage also. So you have to know about how to compute this advantage. This one is a little bit theoretical, right? So maybe you need the time to understand everything. Okay, any question? Nothing. Okay, so see you on Monday. Bye.